it before, and maybe I have, but and it's a powerful song. I love that song. We are getting real close to Christmas. You just proved some of my opening remarks in my introduction this morning. You don't seem very excited about that. No snow. I'm excited about there's no snow. This is the Christmas project. And we're going to be looking at the next 4 weeks at some characters and talking about Christmas and all. If you notice, I've titled this message Project One, Recapturing the Essence. And obviously, some of you need to hear this message because you didn't respond very well to the idea of Christmas. Do you remember when you were a kid, how excited you were for Christmas, how you anticipated Christmas coming and you were giddy and you acted silly? Can anybody remember that? But as you've gotten older, we've all grown up, or most of us have grown up. Is it not true that we've somehow lost some of that silliness, some of that giddiness, some of that excitement about Christmas? Isn't that not true? I personally have this tendency to approach, I approach everything with a business-like mentality. It's just how my head works. It's just the way I'm wired. And so I look for the logic in everything. I decide about things based on the practicality of what we're looking at or what we're doing. And if it's not practical, I'm immediately moving away from it. If I don't see logic in it, I'm immediately moving away from it. I have this understanding, and I know that there is nothing in this world that can create sustainable hope. I know that. My theology teaches me that. I get that. And so what happens a lot of times is because of that mindset, because of that understanding, I have this tendency to cheat myself with some things that I think God really wants me to have and experience. I'm completely aware in regards to the Christmas story and the season, what it's all about. I'm completely aware that Christ came to save me from my sin and to remove me at some point in time from the hopelessness of this world. That's my theology. I get that. I understand that. I know that to be true beyond everything else. And therefore, God sometimes has to take Ralph Morris back and remind him that that it is not only for salvation that he has sent Christ, but that is for abundant life in which he came. And I forget that sometimes. I get caught up in, again, the logic and the practicality of living, and I get to focusing so far down the road that I miss a lot of stuff that's happening that the Lord has put around me right now. He says, relax, son. Relax. Enjoy the life I gave. Paul purposely wrote something to his young protege, Timothy, because I think Timothy was finding himself overwhelmed with ministry. I think he was finding himself just caught up in life. He wrote these words. In 1 Timothy 6, 17 and 19, he said, "Instruct those who are rich in this present world not to be conceited or to fix their hope on the uncertainty of riches, but on God, who richly supplies us with all things to enjoy. Instruct them to be good or to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, storing up for themselves the treasures of a good foundation for the future." And look at this last line, "so that they may take hold of that which is life indeed." You know, as we watch the events of the world again this week, we had that reminder that we're moving closer to the Lord's return. We had that wake-up call that chaos is rising, things are intensifying. We all watched on the news as the world tries to explain and understand these events and what they're all about. It's easy for that stuff, when these events happen and when we see them or read about them, it's easy for us to just feel overwhelmed, to experience anxiety, to begin to worry and be concerned about what's next and what's ahead of our children and our grandchildren and how's it going to play itself out. And it's easy to get really caught up in all of that. And when that happens, we find ourselves not experiencing joy, or again, cheating ourselves. Life on its own, just our own lives, sometimes can be overwhelming, right? Doesn't matter about what's going on in the world. Sometimes our world can cause us to become anxious and overwhelmed and become too serious sometimes about things, and we begin to take on things that we don't need to take on. I'm going to ask you a question. Have you ever looked at something on a regular basis or fairly often and you didn't realize you were missing something there until someone pointed it out to you? How many times have you seen something all the time, you look at it on a regular basis, and all at once somebody says, "Did you notice?" And it's like, I didn't. And you look at it and you begin to see something that was there. You'd never seen it there before. You'd never noticed it at all before. For instance, Paul's going to flip out over this one, and so y'all have to go to him later on and say, "Really, dude? Really?" How many of you have ever set out at night on a clear sky and just looked up at the stars? How many of you have done that? Raise your hand. Okay, put your hand down. How many of you have set out on a clear night and watched satellites pass through the sky? Not even half of you that said you looked at the sky. I want to be honest with you. I never noticed them before. Do you know there's over 35,000 satellites in the sky? 35,000 satellites are orbiting Earth right now. And until someone caused me to stop and pay attention, and it took me a little while to be able to see them, you can actually see them with the naked eye passing by. They're very, very dim, but they're there, and you can see them if you just watch, if you just slow everything down and just watch. All at once, somebody will say, "There's one," and you begin to look, and you'll see it, and then you get, the more you see them, the easier they become for you to spot, right? I've always been there. I just never noticed them until a few years ago. Now, I've looked at the sky my whole life. Never saw one. Sometimes, listen to me, guys, sometimes there are things right before our very eyes, and we never notice. And if we do notice, we fail to recognize the value in them. This morning I got up, Diane had her Facebook open. And Lori had an experience this week that speaks to where I'm going with this message this morning. Lori, I want you to come up here and I want you to share your experience. Her daughter posted on Facebook how thankful she was to have a mother that was gracious and kind. And when I saw this morning, I thought, we are missing opportunities that God places around us to learn something He wants us to learn. Share your story.
Well, I'll give you the condensed version.
Come right over here.
My daughter and I went to Wichita Friday night and saw Garth Brooks in concert. I had always said when he came out of retirement this time that I was going to sell everything but my man and my horse to go see Garth Brooks. We went. And we got in our seats, and we were fairly early because we got there right when the doors open. And Hannah, my daughter, was eating nachos, and we were discussing the fact that, well, you know, these seats aren't terrible. They're not, you know, too bad. You know, I'm just glad I'm here. And so this guy and two girls were walking in front of us, and the guy looked up at us and said, "What are you two looking at?" Well, my philosophy is... you can be a jerk, that's fine, but I don't have to put myself on your level and be a jerk too. So what I said to him was, well, you're wearing shorts and it's a little chilly out here for shorts. And so he proceeds to come up and my daughter, like I said, was eating nachos and he bends down and he takes one of her chips and dips it down in her nacho dip and eats it. And so we're both kind of like, okay. So I asked him if he needed to get by because I assumed maybe he was going to sit, you know, in the same row. No, he said, and he just starts chit-chatting with us, and I'll keep it short, but it came out that we were from Missouri and we had driven 3 hours to come and see Garth Brooks because it's a bucket list item for me. And thankfully my 24-year-old daughter likes to hang out with me, so we came all this way to see Garth Brooks. And he said, well, why is it a bucket list? And I said, well, come on, it's Garth. Who doesn't love Garth, you know? And he bends over and he takes two tickets out of his pocket. And he said, well, my boss is Garth Brooks. And he wants to upgrade your seats to the floor. Well, you can imagine I probably felt like picking myself up off the floor. And... you know, of course, it was, are you serious? And he goes, now I know that you want to jump up and hug me and kiss me all over and everything, but don't do that. Just finish your nachos and go on down to the floor and they'll tell you where you need to go. So we're just like shaking. We can't believe that this is happening. So I would have been completely happy in the very last row on the floor. That would have been just beyond bucket list. And we get down to the floor and the guy goes, oh yeah, come on down, you're in the front row. What? We're in the front row. Garth Brooks touched my hand. No, Gary. But anyway, that in a nutshell is what happened to us. We were on the front row of Garth Brooks. So pretty cool.
What appeared to be a detail. What appeared to be a detail, albeit negative, albeit one that she could have had an entirely different reaction to, but chose to treat this opportunity with kindness and graciousness, revealed something to her she could have missed. On your outline, many people live life failing to value the details that God has put around us, whether they be good or bad. There are lessons, guys, to be learned in the smallest of details. But we have to discipline and we have to train ourselves to pay attention to those details, to look for them, to learn to respond to them correctly. Let me give you a hint as to where I'm going this morning. I used to work for a guy, pulled wrenches for a living for a long time, and I used to be a mechanic for a man that was very instrumental in molding my life and shaping my life, and I worked for him for a long time. And inevitably, there would be from time to time a car come in the shop. And I don't care what you did, I don't care how hard you worked, this thing would not give up. And you couldn't fix it. And you would work and you would work and you would struggle. And you're thinking, you can only charge a customer so much. And we're losing our rear ends here. And you would get frustrated and get aggravated. And when he would watch me and see that I'm just about to lose my mind and set this car on fire, he would walk by, and I've thrown it on the screen. I've heard him say it so many times. He would walk up and he would say this to me: if it wasn't for the hard ones, you would never appreciate the easy ones. Now, I don't want to hear that at that moment, but the truth is still there, because it was that lesson that taught me to appreciate things that I might have taken for granted. I might have just, how many of you have heard the saying, if it's easy, everybody would do it? Pay attention to the details. The Christmas season, it's on us, guys. It's here. And most of us are really laser focused on getting presents and buying presents and making arrangements for our family gatherings and, most of all, financially surviving. God has put right here in the Christmas season, he has put his son, Jesus Christ, as the centerpiece of the season. And rightly so. But he's placing details in the peripheral. And sometimes, and many times, we don't notice them. We don't see them. And those details, if we pay attention to them, accent why he came and why he'll be returning. Even those little bitty lessons at a concert are details that God is using to teach us and to train us as his children to see the abundance of the life that his son wants us to experience. On your outline, sometimes details help us better understand why Jesus came and what it is that he wants to restore. Your fill-in is the word restore, but I want you to take your pens and I want you to circle the word why, and I want you to circle the word what. Sometimes details help us better understand why Jesus came and what it is that he wants to restore. Dr. David Jeremiah has a devotional book out in which he uses the Star of Bethlehem as an allegory, to help us regain our focus on the real star of heaven. In the introduction, he wrote these words, and I'm going to put them on the screen for you to see. It says, there are so many other star-like distractions at this time of year, bright, twinkling diversions that capture our attention without our even realizing it. And many of those stars are fine, gift-giving, get-togethers, traveling to be with family. And then look at this next line that he writes. Our focus should be on how everything at Christmas becomes more meaningful and assumes its rightful priority in our life when we give Jesus Christ the star treatment that he deserves. It is so easy for us to become distracted and frustrated with this tapestry and all of the negative details that go along with the Christmas season. It's easy for us to get caught up in that. It's easy for us to get distracted by those things. Because every one of them have the potential of removing our focus off of the centerpiece, off of Christ during Christmas. The Bah Humbug attitude can crowd into us and creep into our lives if we're not really careful. And we get lost in all of this chaos that's going on around the Christmas season. And we begin to display negative attitudes. Lori could have easily been very negative back. She didn't know she was being set up. That might have been the guy's real attitude. Maybe that store clerk, that might be their attitude. That person that cuts you off in traffic, that person that butts in line, that person knocks you down in the aisle to get that gift. All of the stuff that goes on, the commercialization and all of this, man, it is so easy to get caught up in the chaos and miss the details. This morning, what I want us to try to do together is to recapture the joy of Christmas. It's to not allow the negative details to steal from us that which Christ wants us to have during this season and what he wants us to be able to experience during this season. I want to try to help you see something maybe you haven't seen before this Christmas season. On your outline, guys, sometimes the negative details, circle that, negative details. Sometimes the negative details surrounding Christmas are what God wants to use to open our hearts to the real purpose of Christmas. This morning when I was looking at this outline, I wrote a note out there beside that fill in there, camp on this. Camp on this. The negative details surrounding Christmas could very well be the details that God wants to use to change our heart, to open our heart to the real purpose of Christmas. Let's go back to the first century. Let's go back over 2,000 Christmases ago. And let's look at some of the details that surrounded that first Christmas. Luke 1:26-55. In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored, the Lord's with you." But Mary was troubled, greatly troubled at his words. She wondered what kind of greeting this might be, but the angel said to her, "Don't be afraid, Mary. You found favor with God." It's a teenage girl. "But you found favor with God. You'll be with child. You'll give birth to a son. You'll give him the name Jesus." This is getting complicated. Talk about negative details. "Be great. He'll be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father, and he'll reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." Once in a while, there's a song that's written, and it's timeless. A lot of songs are written, and a lot of songs are played on the radio for a period of time, and they kind of tend to just drift away, and new stuff comes, but once in a while there are certain songs that are written. There are certain songs that we learn that are timeless. One of the songs that I believe will be timeless, that will fit into that category, is the song, Mary, Did You Know? There's something that's just powerful about that song and that lyric. As you listen to that song and as you get your mind, it draws you in as you think about this teenage girl, this unwed teenage girl. And as you listen to this, to the song, it's just like, did you know? Could you have known? How will this be, Mary asked the angel, since I am a virgin? The angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come upon you and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the true Son of God, or the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. There's some complications. And she who was said to be barren in her sixth month, for nothing is impossible with God. I am the Lord's servant, Mary answered. May it be to me as you have said. And the angel left her. At that time, Mary got ready, hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. And when Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. And in a loud voice, she exclaimed, blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. Why am I so favored? The mother of my Lord should come to me. As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ear, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. Blessed is she who has believed that what the Lord has said to her will be accomplished. And Mary said, my soul glorifies the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arms. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, even as he said to our fathers. Hope of restoration. Let's go on to Luke chapter 2. Pick it up in verse 8 through 12. There were shepherds living in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. And the angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. The angel said to them, don't be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord, and this will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. And drop down to verse 25 in that same chapter. Now there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon, who was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And moved by the Spirit, he went into the temple courts, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what the custom of the law required, Simeon took him up in his arms, and he praised God, saying, Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you now dismiss your servant in peace, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and glory for your people Israel. And we jump back to Matthew chapter 2 and pick it up in verse 9. And they, after they had heard the king, they being the Magi from Persia, foreigners, when they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them, and until it stopped over the place where the child was. And when they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they filled the child with his mother. They saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and they worshiped him. They opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and incense and myrrh. And back up to verse 7, Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child. When you have found him, bring me word that I too may come and worship him." And then drop down to verse 16, Herod, when he saw he had been tricked by the wise men, became furious. He killed all the male children in Bethlehem and in all that region who were 2 years old and under, according to the time that he had ascertained from the wise men. The reason that I wanted to share all the scripture with you this morning and read it out loud to you is so that you would realize that there were lots of things happening all around Jesus in that first Christmas. There's chaos. There were some very negative details involved. There was complications. There was interruptions. There were expectations. All surrounding the arrival of this baby, this son, his son. It wasn't the romantic utopia that is sometimes portrayed in the presentations of pageantry that we see during the Christmas season. It wasn't pristine. It wasn't sterile. It wasn't perfect as sometimes the Christmas cards seem to portray it to be. It was hard. It was difficult. It was frightening. It was uncertain. All of these elements exist, negative details. Listen, guys, it's the chaos that surrounded the joy of the event that's often missed. And it's in that chaos that we can learn some of the greatest lessons that we can ever learn about joy and about peace and about our faith. We gloss over those details because we want to see the main thing. We want to somehow create this romantic idea of the event. When our Father in heaven says, "It's what I want you to see in the negative that I can teach you the most. It's what I want you to understand." In those things, you're missing it. And if the same is true in our life, We keep looking forward to with the expectation of something to turn out a certain way. But along the way, there's complications. Along the way, there's interruption. Along the way, there's disruption. And we find ourselves getting frustrated and angry and fearful. And all of those things happen when it is in those things that the Lord is saying, "Slow down. Learn from me. So that you can know joy. So that you can recapture the essence of the season. And why I sent him. And why he's coming back." Mary, a teenager, had to endure the stigma of being a pregnant, unwed teenager in a culture that would demonize her. She could have been stoned. Can you imagine the pressure? Disconnect with me, if you will, for a moment from the romance of the story and think about the parents in this situation. Think about the culture in which they lived. Think about the fear of this teenage girl and knowing what could take place and what could happen. Imagine Joseph and his family and the pressure that may have been on them because of this culture that existed. Talk about negative details. Elizabeth, in her old age, was now found to be pregnant and her husband Zachariah couldn't talk. Some of you women are saying, "That would be awesome." But talk about, think about this. I thought about this morning. I thought, heaven forbid that Don and I ever have another baby now. You talk about turning a house upside down. You talk about disruption. They would have been settled into a routine, a routine of normalcy. And now a baby's coming in. And they're old. Mary and Joseph, by a state decree, were forced to travel to Bethlehem to report for a state-sanctioned census that the government had put on them in the latter days of her pregnancy. They had problems finding lodging when they arrived in Bethlehem, and they ended up giving birth in a stable. In a stable. Some of y'all gross out over the fact that when you go to a restaurant, there might be a hair in your food. Yeah, I swear I'm going to lose my man card over this one. I really am. But I had to drive the bus last night for a bunch of you women. The highlight of my night was putting you all in jail. I can only imagine what people thought at Olive Garden when they walked by and I'm sitting at a big table with 11 women. Guy must be Mormon. Some were saying, "All right, man." Others are saying, "Oh, gosh, man." I don't even know where I was going to go with all this now. But imagine, sometimes the best laid plans and logistics. I wasn't planning on doing that last night. And Diana kept looking at me with this murky little grin on her face that nobody else could understand but me. And she's looking and smiling and saying, "You're dying inside, aren't you?" I didn't plan to do that last night. That's an interruption to my thought, to my plan, to what I had intended. So, what in the world do you want me to learn in this thing, Lord? The best laid plans can completely change because of unforeseen circumstances. It happens to us all the time. Something breaks down. All of us right now are living in fear of our vehicles breaking down right now, right? Right now. Not now. June, but not now. Later on, but not at Christmas. Or hot water heater going out. Yeah. Or something happening that is going to cause an unexpected expense. Negatives, details. What about these shepherds? I wrote about them in my blog this week. How many of you saw that I'm back on the blog again? It's like falling off the wagon, huh? But I'm back on the blog. I wrote about these shepherds. You know, the shepherds who were considered continually unclean, unable to participate in any temple or synagogue activities, were the ones chosen to first hear the good news. Now I looked at that and I thought, what's this all about? You see, Christmas often brings with it unexpected surprises, both good and sometimes bad. Things you would never anticipate and you weren't expecting to happen. Well, the shepherds had lived their lives believing that the mold had been cast for them. They were outcast of society. Because of what they did, They could never participate in temple activities. They could never participate in synagogue activities. They, as I wrote about this week, were often considered to be thieves and dishonest, and they were the lowest of the lowest in the society as a Jew. They didn't probably really live much in expectation of life ever being any different. This is my lot in life. This is how it's going to be from now on. It's who I am. It's what I was born into. It's what I do. This is it. It's probably the mindset of the shepherd. And yet, they were given an opportunity, a surprise. Simeon, you know, Simeon had lived his whole life in expectation of something. And he's getting old. And time appeared to be running out. You know, I thought about this and I come up with this. Sometimes frustration can build around our expectations that end up driving us away from what God wants to teach us. You know, I got to wonder, were there some days that maybe when Simeon got up and he realizes that he's getting older and he's not getting around as well and he's, you know, and it's like, okay, it's time for the Messiah to come. I know the scripture. I understand the timing of events and he should be coming at any time. And Lord, you've promised that I will get to see the Christ before I die. But it hadn't happened. Hadn't happened yet. And sometimes when you and I live in expectation of something and we look forward to something and we anticipate it and it doesn't happen when we think it should and we wonder, is it going to ever happen? That detail, that experience can frustrate us and it can steal from us, can rob us of joy. Sometimes we get to a place where we just start to give up. The Magi's joyful visit had become complicated due to the fact that Herod wanted to kill Jesus. You know, I'm not going to get to preach about the Magi this year, but I love preaching about the Magi. I love talking about them because their role in the early stages, early years of Jesus' life and the first few Christmases, it's amazing how God orchestrated that and what he used that for and how he worked all that out. But they can't even be free of disruption and uncertainty and struggle and all when they come because of Herod and what he's wanting and what he's plotting, and they got to be so careful and so cautious and not mess up and not make a mistake and not reveal the location of Christ. And they've got to, in their entourage, get out of town undetected. And some of you like to leave some family get-togethers that way, don't you? Let's just kind of sneak out. Sometimes difficult and unreasonable people in your life can make Christmas hard to enjoy, right? Sometimes it's hard to enjoy Christmas because in your family, in your workplace, you got that unreasonable, hard person, negative person that you got to deal with and you got to put up with. I've only touched on just a few of the negatives that have the potential to have robbed the joy of this first Christmas. And over 2,000 Christmases later, we are still experiencing the negatives of the season that rob us that steal joy from us. Well, how can we experience joy during this season when there are so many things to steal it from us? Let's go all the way back to Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 9, verses 1 and 7. And let's hold to something that they held to in the first Christmases. Something that they understood. And something that kept them looking forward all of the time. That allowed Mary to sing this beautiful song that she did. To allow Elizabeth to be excited. To allow Simeon to just be satisfied. To allow the Magi to do what they came to do in spite of everything that was going on. And allowed the shepherds to rise above their circumstances in which that had been dictated to them. Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who are in distress. In the past, he humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but in the future, he will honor Galilee of the Gentiles, by the way, a sea along the Jordan. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light on those living in the land of the shadow of death. A light has dawned, and you have enlarged the nation, increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as men rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boots used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning and will be fuel for the fire. That is what's to come. That is which is beyond or before us still. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given. The government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end, and he will reign on David's throne and over the kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on forever. The zeal of the Lord will accomplish this. That, in a nutshell, is exactly what our faith is all about. As a follower of Christ, everything we believe is wrapped up right there in that prophecy. Everything. It's what we've been talking about for weeks now. The truth is that we're surrounded by chaos. And sometimes that chaos causes us to feel this sense of hopelessness. But if we can find a way to look into that chaos and into all that appears to be negative around us, he'll point out to us and show us a glimpse. And maybe it will just be a glimpse, but he will show us a glimpse of why he came and why he's coming back. It doesn't matter how chaotic our life might get. It doesn't matter how difficult circumstances or people may become in our life. It doesn't matter what is going on. If we look at what he's trying to get us to see, even in those things, we get a glimpse of why Jesus came and why he's coming back. You see, chaos and a sense of hopelessness are not indicators that there is no hope. On your outline, guys, hope nor hopelessness lies in our circumstances. Hope lies with a person whose name is Jesus. In Christ, we can know hope in this life, and it won't matter if all hell's broke loose. It won't matter what's going on. It won't matter how negative the details are around us. We can, in Christ, still experience joy and peace. All of these people that we read about and talked about in the scripture that I read. All of the people that experienced the first Christmas, they lived in expectation of what Christ would restore. And that's why they were so excited. That's why they were so joyful. Because of the expectation of what Jesus was going to do. There is a day coming that there will be no distractions and there will be no chaos. That day's coming. And that simple knowledge, just that simple knowledge, makes it possible to experience the abundant life that He has promised. Just knowing that, it can remove us from our circumstances. Guys, buying gifts, having get-togethers, traveling to see family, going to Christmas parties, these are all good things that God has given us to enjoy. And that's what Paul wanted to remind Timothy of. He's given us all things to enjoy. Don't miss out on living because of life. Does that make sense to you? Don't miss out on living because of life. All these things are good things. Know that it is possible to live in the middle of chaos, in the middle of distractions, in the middle of hard to deal with people, in the middle of uncertainty. It's possible to live in those places and know joy and know peace because you have an expectation of something that we have been promised. And that's in His return. So, preacher, practically, what can I do? Because I am a person of practicality. What can I do tomorrow? Or what can I do this afternoon? Or what can I do throughout the week? I'm going to give you some stuff, and we're going to wind this up with this. It's on your outline. Why don't you pay attention to some details and watch what God teaches you. Speak an encouraging word into the life of someone that may be having a bad day. You're going to run into some people having some bad days as we move towards Christmas. How about speaking a word of encouragement? Don't miss that opportunity. When you see it, when it's there, and you don't necessarily feel like it, and you're that person's being a jerk, or they're just so negative, our Father's saying, I want you to see something here. I want you to experience something. Speak an encouragement word to Him. Watch. See what I do. Put some money in a red kittle or in a turkey's basket in front of a store. Or give somebody standing at a stoplight or an underpass a few dollars to help them along. What's it going to hurt? They'll buy drugs or they'll buy booze or, you know, they just might buy some food. But none of that matters. Because what matters, the detail there is, and Dinah and I did this the other day, And I said to her, I said, I'm thankful I'm not standing next to that stop sign with a sign in my hand. I don't have to go beg. I'm not in a circumstance or situation to where I am compelled to go beg somebody for something. I don't care what they do with that money. I really don't care. Because that's not what the Lord wants me to learn. It's not what He wants to do in Ralph Morse's life. Nothing to do with them. It's all about what He's doing here with me. Another one, smile. Smile. I had a hard time smiling with 11 women last night. I'm going to tell you. I'm going to pay for this stuff. I guarantee it. Smile at someone that seems to be having a bad day. Or do a kind deed for someone that seems hurried. You're going to have people try to run you over this season. It's okay to take a step back and smile. It's not about them. Buy a gift for someone that might not expect it. You know, I hear so many people say this, man, I gotta get the kids their gifts. I gotta get this person that one. I still got this one left, and I got this on the list that I gotta get done. I gotta take care of that thing and offer that person. And oh man, I forgot I gotta buy a stupid elephant gift for somebody at work. And what about just buying a gift for somebody that's not going to expect it? Just because. What about paying for somebody's meal just to bless them? You can't believe how much fun that is. And Diane and I used to do this a lot, and we've kind of gotten away from doing it. We probably ought to resurrect this again. It's just so cool to go out for breakfast some morning or something, be sitting there, and when it comes time to pay your bill, just tell the waitress, said, go pick that ticket up off that table and tell them that you forgot to put something on it or you need to do something. Just bring it to me. Or how about this? Just all of us have some degree of discernment, and you sometimes can read into the face of a waitress or wait, or somebody, and especially during a busy time when they're just going from table to table and they've already been kind of worked on by somebody at another table, and they just feel like that they're just, I mean, you can just kind of sense that they feel like that, man, I got to get done. I got to keep up. And maybe they're not as slow and gracious with you as they need to be or whatever. Or you just trust the Holy Spirit in a situation when you just kind of sense something about this person that maybe they might struggle here at Christmas. Maybe it's a single mom. You don't know, but you just kind of listen to the Spirit of the Lord as He leads you. How about leaving them a $20 tip or $50 tip or something? Along with a little note saying, just want to bless you. Walk out. Demonstrate love to your spouse, your children, and your grandchildren. Demonstrate it, not through the giving of a gift. Demonstrate it in the flesh. Encourage them, reassure them. Demonstrate it. Find a way. Read the Christmas story with your family. Just before Christmas, our greeters and our hosts will be handing out a copy of the Christmas story. I've gone through, I've taken all the scripture, I've put it in chronological order. It's in a format that's very easy to read. There is something so powerful about getting your family together on Christmas Eve or on Christmas morning and just gathering them up and just taking time to read the story with your family. Just to slow down and read the story. And we're going to have that for you. To give you. This last one. Reach out to someone who may be lonely this season. A lot of lonely people. Reach out to them. In each and every one of those little details, guys, in each and every one of those little details, you're being Christ to someone during this season. And maybe it's not even about them in each and every situation. But it's about what Jesus is wanting you to learn about Him in each of those situations. You see, we want to just gripe and complain again about people taking Christ out of Christmas and using Xmas or saying Happy Holidays instead of Merry Christmas, and we get mad about that and we get irritated about that. And just being Jesus during the Christmas season. If they don't say Merry Christmas to you, then they don't say Merry Christmas to you. But you can say Merry Christmas to them. And you can smile at them. You don't know what the pressure on that store clerk or that person, you don't know what pressure their employer is putting on them. You don't know what is required of them. Be gracious. Just be gracious. Paul told the Colossian people in Colossians 3:17, he said, whatever you do in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through Him to God your Father. Man, if we fail to see the opportunities of this season, we risk losing joy. That's what it comes down to. If we miss opportunities, we risk losing our joy. Don't let nothing steal your joy this year. Don't let nothing steal your joy. Here's your takeaway. Celebrate Christmas out loud. Y'all know what that means. Celebrate Christmas out loud so that everyone you meet gets a glimpse of the hope that God has given you in this life. So live a joyful and thankful life. Recapture the essence of the season. As we finish, I want to speak to you if you've not trusted Jesus for salvation. What a better time to seek Him, to ask forgiveness, to recognize your need for Him, to find the joy in just knowing Him and why He's coming back. I, more than anything, want an opportunity to talk to you about Him if you've never trusted Him. Please connect with me. We have new connection cards, and this side over here, guys, we ran out. We didn't get them all put in. So if you need one, grab them out of a seat as you go out the door. We'll have more here soon. Grab a business card of mine out there on the resource table. Give me a call. Send me a text. Shoot me an email. Fill out a card. Put it in the offering. Drop it in the box. Hand it to me on the way out the door. But please connect with me. Give me that opportunity to sit down and talk to you about Jesus. Let's pray. Well, Father, I just want to thank You for this season. Sometimes we get caught up in it so much and we just completely miss what's there. What You want us to know. It's a season of worship. It's a season of being able to just be reminded of Your love for us. I pray for pray for this church. I pray for those who will are following us on the web. I just pray, God, that you'll just show yourself this season in a new and a fresh manner. And we'll learn more about walking like Jesus did. I pray this in your name. Amen. Y'all have a great day.